be.
Good morning. We have talked in the past about the fact that punctuation matters. You may remember what I just had up there on the screen. The last time, it said, let's eat kitty, and I almost got stoned. But it's important, right? That comma's important. I mean, it's all in how we read things, it's how we say things. There's a lot of times when the way we read things or the way things are written don't come across as the way they're supposed to. I found a few humorous examples this past week. I just want to look at a few of them. The police begin campaign to run down jaywalkers. It all depends on how you read it, right? Miners refuse to work after death. Understandable. War dims hope for peace. Okay. Hospital is sued by 7-foot doctors. Red tape holds up new bridges. I'm not driving there. I don't care who's building bridges. Local high school dropouts cut in half. That seems pretty severe to me. Kids make nutritious snacks. Typhoon rips through cemetery, hundreds dead. Imagine that. They're funny, at least I think they're funny. In case you haven't noticed, sometimes I like to insert a little bit of humor into the sermons. I don't want to take away from the seriousness of the message of God, but sometimes we need to laugh, or sometimes Christians need to maybe loosen up a little bit and giggle and laugh and have some fun. Because the world's messed up. We have to face the messed up world all the time, every day. So sometimes we have to stop and laugh. Most Christians, it seems, can agree that the world's messed up. But it's what's wrong with the world that sometimes we as Christians can't agree on. There are two great big giant controversies going on right now that involve Christians. One of them you most likely know about, the other one you may or may not have heard about yet. It's relatively new. It hit the internet last Sunday, and I'll tell you about that in just a moment. You see that conservative Christians are up in arms over the things that the government's doing and the decisions that are being made, and liberal Christians are pretty much going with the worldly flow, believing that acceptance and tolerance are the answer, and that conservative Christians are the problem. Huh. I wonder why nobody wants to join the church. These are the things that are going on. Who knows what's going on in Kentucky? With this county clerk. They threw her in jail. Then they let her out. Now she's appealing again. Somebody asked my opinion about this. I'm going to give it to you. Some of you are probably not going to agree with me. That's why it's called an opinion. I believe she is sincere in her efforts. I applaud the fact that she's willing to take a stand for what she believes in. Issuing marriage license is part of her job. Resign from your job.
Amen.
I don't know of any place of employment now. If you may work in a place where you're allowed to voice your opinion, you're allowed to challenge the things that are going on, but I don't know of any place where you could just flat go in and refuse to do your job and keep your job. I was writing a sermon and I thought about this kid that used to work for me in the fast food business. He missed 5 days of work in a row, when I say kid, young man, in his 20s. And when he finally showed up, this is what he said. Before you fired me, and I said, wait a minute. Oh, but she didn't want to fire me. You already quit. He said, no, I didn't. I said, yeah, you quit coming to work. That's what quit means, right? So if she quits doing her job, then maybe she needs to resign that job, and listen to me now, maybe she has enough momentum right now to run for some state or local office where she can make a difference. Where she can be part of the voting process that makes that difference. That's my opinion on the Kentucky situation. That's the conservative issue right now before the church. Use the internet, like I said, particularly social media. You may have heard of the latest liberal Christian controversy that's going on. If you haven't, you can Google this when you get home. If you use the internet, you'll see what I'm talking about. There is a video out there right now that's called, I'm not these young people say, and I don't criticize them for being young, and I'm not criticizing them at all. This is what the video says. I am Christian, but I am not unintelligent. I am not judgmental. I am Christian. I am not, make sure I'm using the right words here. I am Christian, but I'm not closed-minded. I'm a Christian, but I'm not judgmental. I'm a Christian, but I'm not homophobic. I'm a Christian, but I'm not arrogant. And I'm a Christian, but I'm not uneducated. Now, those statements in and of themselves sound awesome. That's great. But if you watch the video, the whole premise of the video is, I'm a Christian, but I'm not like those other Christians. That's how all the other Christians are. And I'm not like them. So when I watched that, I thought, wow, that doesn't come across very good. Like I said, if you think I'm just being overly sensitive, you can watch the video and see if you think they're criticizing all things Christian. They go on, it continues with two of the young ladies claiming to be gay, two others, along with one young man telling us that they are feminists. I don't know how that works. And a young lady who claims to not believe in sex outside of marriage, but who tells us that she is willing to give us advice on sex outside of marriage. The thing that bothered me most about the video is the title that says, I am Christian, but nowhere in the video do you hear a word sin, salvation, or Jesus. This is going to be a big controversy within the church. It's coming. When this thing explodes, it had like 10,000 hits as of Wednesday, I think, 10,000 views. When it gets out there to everybody, it's going to be a problem. So that's the emerging controversy on the liberal side of Christianity. So one side thinks the conservatives are what's wrong with the world, and the other side thinks it's the liberals that are what's wrong with the world. Here's what I think is wrong with the world. People are dying and going to hell, and the church is not doing anything about it. That's what I think is wrong. All that other stuff is stuff. Because if the church is being the church, all that other stuff will go away. It won't matter. So that's what I think is wrong with the world. How do you have life? One of the things that I mentioned at the beginning of this series is that we can't do what Jesus said unless we know what Jesus said. And the only way to know what Jesus said to know the Word. We have to know what's in the Bible before we can use it in any way, shape, or form as Christians. I'll admit this is one of the few times in this series where the message is built more on what Jesus did than on what Jesus said. You've all heard that quote, preach the gospel, and if necessary, use words. By the way, Francis of Assisi didn't say that, but anyway, it's a neat saying. Just something somebody came up with. But it's true, and I believe that's what Jesus did here. In defending what he knew was right, if you have your Bible and you want to follow along, open it to Matthew chapter 4. Spend a little time there in a few minutes. Before we read from that gospel, though, I want to point to some early scripture that makes clear the importance of us knowing what the Bible says. We're going to be able to defend our faith and lead others to a relationship with Jesus. We need to be able to do that intelligently, knowing what we believe and why we believe it. One of our core beliefs as Christians is that the Bible is the Word of God. Amen? Everything in it is true. We've seen that on the screen today. They talked about it in Sunday school classes this morning. It's the Word of God. And we believe it. We say that, we better know what it says. And God himself gives us a perfect example of that way back in the beginning. You can follow along the screen for this part of the message. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? Now how many times today have you heard people say, did God really say that? That's what God said. But let's go back to Genesis chapter 2 and see what God really said. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die. We read that and we come to the conclusion that the answer to the serpent's question is no, God did not say that. When we come back to chapter 3, we see that Eve gives even a more detailed answer. The woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. Out to me when I read the story of Adam and Eve and the snake and the tree is the fact that God told Adam, if we flip back, God told Adam about the tree. Remember, God told Adam about the tree. Let's go back. Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat from it, you will certainly die. If you read that, if you read chapter 2, after that, God creates Eve. So how does Eve know what God said? I'm pretty sure when God created Eve and Adam and Eve were walking through the garden the first couple of times, Adam said, that tree's off limits. God said we can't have that. Because if we go back, God didn't say if you touch it, you're going to die, but that's what Eve said. So I think Adam probably said, don't even touch it. Don't go near that tree. Maybe this was the first instance of man trying to manipulate the Word of God. We know that's what the serpent was doing. That's what non-believers and even some Christians say today, right? They say, is that really what the Bible says? Does the Bible really say that? We hear people asking, is that really what Jesus meant? We even have some arrogant Christians out there going, that's not what God meant. Really? If it says God said, I'm pretty sure that's what God meant. It's how we read things that can make a difference. The fact that this is the very thing that corrupted the world way back in the beginning is a pretty clear indication that we have to know and understand the scriptures if we want to be effective for the kingdom. Anyway, Adam and Eve knew exactly what God had said. So the enemy tries a new tactic. You will not die, the serpent said to the woman. For God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. You're really not going to die. See, what God really meant was he doesn't want you to eat that, because then you'll be equal with him. And he doesn't want that. So don't eat that apple or that fruit or whatever you want to call that. Well, Satan said. That sounds to me like Satan saying, is that what God really said? Maybe you didn't understand God completely. Interesting note you may have missed. I just mentioned that God said don't eat from the tree. Eve said that God said don't even touch the tree. And Adam and Eve stuck to their guns and followed God's words. They would have been able to resist the temptation that the serpent put in front of them. And the temptation to be like God. Because that's what it boiled down to, right? Satan said, if you eat that, you're going to be like God. And they went, okay. Maybe we should eat from that tree. I've already talked a lot this morning about knowing exactly what the Bible says so that we can defend our faith. And that's important. The core section of the New Testament that I'm going to use this morning for the message, though, shows the other side of why we need to know the Word. We can't stand up to and resist the temptations of the enemy until we know the promises that are found in Scripture. Because us, you want to go take on Satan, the devil, by yourself? Go. You'll lose. If we had that power, Jesus wouldn't have needed to go to the cross. So we don't have that power. But Jesus does. In Matthew chapter 4, we find an account of a verbal exchange between Jesus and the devil. This is one of those times when Jesus experiences the same things that we sometimes experience. I've had this discussion with some of you. In the previous chapter of Matthew, Jesus had just been baptized. And if you'll remember, when Jesus was baptized, and then he came up out of the water, they audibly heard God say, "This is my Son with whom I am well pleased, whom I love." And then it says, the Spirit of God came down like a dove onto Jesus. I have to think at that point in his life, Jesus is on a pretty good spiritual high. And you've all been there. You've all had God moments. Maybe it was when you were baptized. Maybe it was when we have these God moments, right now. Maybe it's when you've just been so far down that you've had no choice but just to surrender everything and say, okay, I can't. And then all of a sudden God steps in and you can, and you realize where your power comes from. That's a pretty good feeling, isn't it? And then what happens? John Giorizzo can tell you what happens. And Satan shows up. See, John's been trying to play his music in church for quite a while. And every time he does, then something happens. John's having surgery a couple weeks ago. We got this, right? But things can be going really well in your spiritual life, and then all of a sudden, here comes the enemy, and let me stop right there and just make a point. If you don't believe in the devil, you can turn your hearing off right now. Because we have to believe that before any of this makes any difference at all. Because Satan will come in when you're on a roll for Christ and try to slow you down. And I'm convinced this is a time when Jesus was having a really, really good experience. And here comes Satan. Many times when we have these great experiences, other people can even recognize our joy and our hope. Maybe that will be an encouragement to them. But like I said, guess who else recognizes your joy and your hope? The devil. He will be right there to try to take you away from God. That's when he feels the need to go on the offensive. And that's exactly what's happening to Jesus as it's recorded in Matthew chapter 4. Let's read beginning at verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit. Let me stop right there. Notice it doesn't say Jesus was led by the devil. Jesus was led by the Spirit of God into this confrontation with the devil. I believe he put the devil in his place. Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." Jesus answered him, "It is also written, do not put your Lord God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all of the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give to you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." Like I said a few minutes ago, I'll admit that there's nowhere in there where Jesus actually says that you need the word. Isn't it interesting and enlightening, though, that when Jesus is tempted, his source or his choice of weapon for resisting temptation is the word of God, the Holy Scriptures. Jesus could have simply made the devil go away. He could have done anything he wanted. But rather than turn stones to bread, he could have turned that one into something to eat. Right? He could have done whatever he wanted. He could have said, "I'll show you bread." Rather than throwing himself off the highest point of the temple, guess what? He could have thrown the devil off the highest point of the temple. That would have showed the devil, huh? Rather than bow down and worship Satan, Jesus could have forced Satan to bow down and worship God. Right there on the spot. Instead, Jesus went into battle with his weapon of choice being what the Apostle Paul refers to in Ephesians chapter 6, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. There is no more powerful weapon than that of temptation. And Jesus understood that. And that had to frustrate the devil. Here he was trying to tempt Jesus himself or bow down in order to be rewarded with worldly wealth. Jesus just simply relied on what he knew to be true. What would the church look like today if we did that? We do, sometimes. And when we do, sometimes we just pull out the ones we want because they fit our position. We're going to talk about that a little bit more here just in a moment. In Matthew chapter 4, if you're looking at your Bible, you have footnotes telling you the exact Old Testament scriptures that Jesus refers to when he's answering the devil. In verse 4, Jesus paraphrases Deuteronomy 8:3. Look back here, where Jesus says, "It is written, man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God." If you go back and do a word study on that word live, the word that's translated to the word live in that verse, it could just as easily and probably more literally be translated experience life. There is a huge difference between being alive and experiencing life. You can't actually live on bread alone for a very, 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 very long time. But you can't experience life without the Word of God. So that's Jesus' first response to Satan. He's saying that it takes more than physical food to experience life. Now let's look at something that we can relate to in verse 6. Satan says, "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands, so that you will not strike your foot against a stone." That's impressive. Because now, to battle Jesus in the scriptures, what does Satan do? Pulls out the scriptures. Anybody ever had a discussion with a believer or a non-believer, where you're trying to convince them of something and they pull something else out of the Bible to try to counter what you're trying to tell them? That's what Satan did. I can almost imagine Jesus saying, "Good try. Well, at least you know your scriptures. But if you know your scriptures, you can't just pull out the ones you want." And Jesus makes that really clear. He basically tells the devil, yes, those words are in Psalm 91, which you had on the screen earlier today. I did notice that. If you're going to use scripture, you have to use them all. Jesus wrote, or Jesus answered him, "It is also written, do not put the Lord your God in the text." Unlike those we encounter today, the devil doesn't argue. He just moves on to the next temptation. And maybe you've experienced that in your life. Maybe you beat one temptation, no problem. I'm over it. I can handle this. And the next one comes. And the next one comes. This is my favorite in terms of imagining how Jesus could have reacted. Verse 8. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all of the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." I almost laughed when I heard that. Because you almost expect Jesus' response to be, "It's already mine. What makes you think you have any control over all of that? That's mine. The scriptures say it was made by me, for me, and through me. Why do you think you have any claim to it?" But, again, Jesus didn't do that. Simply refer to Deuteronomy one more time. The first half of Deuteronomy 6:13 says, "Fear the Lord your God. Serve him only." In each of these instances, as I've already said, Jesus could have responded in a number of different ways. Yet each time the Son of God turned to the Word of God. My question for us this morning is, if it's good enough for Jesus, why is it not sometimes good enough for us? Every answer to every issue is in here. It's like I said at the beginning, it's important in knowing it, and it's how we read it and how we apply it makes all the difference in the world. As followers of Jesus, we need to be prepared to do the same. And I know what you're thinking, because I think it sometimes too. This is Jesus, okay? Jesus can stand up to the devil. I'm just a mere mortal. You're right. But if you know this, and you are confident in it being the truth, then you can use this to battle temptation. Last week I said that the Bible says, quit acting like mere mortals. So that excuse doesn't fly for us anymore. Yes, we're going to face trouble in this life. Absolutely. And knowing everything that's in the Bible is not going to stop you from facing trouble in this life. Knowing what's in the Bible and the promises that are held there and the truths that are held there will make it easier to face the troubles that you have in this life. There might be someone here that's never made a commitment to be a Christ follower. Maybe that's where you're at. Maybe you're listening to this guy up here and you're going, what? Maybe nobody's ever told you what the Bible says. Or maybe you've gotten conflicting versions of what the Bible says. Maybe you're just confused because you don't know what the Bible really says. Maybe none of what I've said about Jesus and experiencing life and the devil and temptation and the Word of God, maybe none of that makes any sense to you at all. World has people in it to whom that makes no sense at all. There's a way to find out. If you're that person and you want to start figuring out what it's all about, the first step is to take the first step. And that first step is to accept that the Word of God is true, that we're all sinners in need of a Savior, that Jesus is that final Savior, and that you're ready to accept His gift of forgiveness. Salvation. Don't let the devil hold you back. Jesus already beat him up more than once. Aren't you glad they recorded that for us? We know who wins in the end. So we're going to sing, and if you need to take that step, just walk right up front. I'll stand with you in your decision, and we'll take it from there. You want someone to pray with you, if you want to join this body of believers in membership, we'll stand with you in those decisions as well. But the biggest deal of all is recognizing that this is the Word of God, and what's in it is true, and the promises that are in it are for everyone. As for the rest of us, I believe that Jesus' use of the Scripture in battling the temptations of the devil is His way of saying, know the Word. Let's pray. God, we love you. Thank you for your Word. Write it on our hearts. Teach us to apply it to our lives. Teach us to know how to use it, not in defense of what we think is right and wrong, but in defense of you. You don't need us to stand up for you, God. But we know that when we can properly speak the gospel, people will be led to Jesus. I pray that you give us the strength and the courage and the wisdom and the knowledge to do those things, so that others might be reunited with you through the sacrifice that was made by your Son, Jesus. Father, as we continue through this day and this week and our lives, I pray that you would use us, that you would use your Word, and that more people would come to your salvation.
Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty?